People are mad about Starlink, mostly astronomers, because the night sky is now plagued by streaks ruining all ground-based observations. There's a bunch of other problems, but given how space-agey this sounds, we should kinda know how to deal with this, right? Given that we've kinda been here before? Allow me to present to you Project Westford, when Space Age America decided to launch a bunch of copper needles into space. The story is set during the Cold War, when there was a lot of paranoia about how information traveled across the world. This was before communication satellites, so there were only two ways of sending information across the world: undersea cables and bouncing radio waves off of the ionosphere. Neither were perfect. One, you could simply cut the cables and cut America off from the rest of the world. Two, the ionosphere is a layer of moving gas, which is pretty unstable and unpredictable. So anyway, to tackle this problem, America thought it would be a good idea to launch 480 million copper needles into space. The idea was to have a diode antenna, which is just a metal rod, the length of which specifies exactly which wavelength the antenna would be most sensitive to. These needles were 1.78 centimeters long to pick up the 8 gigahertz signals that was used. The plan was to deploy a large number of these so that they created a nice, even, predictable blanket over the atmosphere that you could use to send signals to wherever you wanted to send them. It was basically a space radio mirror. They first launched in 1961 and the needles did not disperse properly. They first launched it successfully in 1963. Hooray! So what happened to the American Space Needle program? Well, people started protesting back then for the same reasons why people are protesting Starlink today. It ruins ground-based radio astronomy and it clutters space up. But of course, that wasn't quite enough to move the superpower that America was. What did kill this program was the development of the communication satellite. A much safer technology that essentially made this whole ordeal pointless. There was another problem called cold welding. Normal welding is when two bits of metal get so hot that the surfaces melt where they would then be attached. The idea is the attaching. In space, if you have two really clean bits of metal that are really close to each other, then, to paraphrase Feynman, there's no way for the atoms of one metal to differentiate atoms from itself to another. And so, a lot of these needles clump up in space to form spike balls. This is especially true for the ones that did not deploy correctly in 1961, as they were more likely to hit one another, increasing the probability that they would attach themselves to each other. Of course, once the rest of the world figured out what the hell was going on, things went mildly insane. There was a lot of debate and discussion around this, and it eventually reached the United Nations. Several studies were published to explain why this is mostly harmless, that these needles would only stay up for about 3 years, no big deal. Nevertheless, the international protests were louder than these arguments that America posed and sort of led to the 1967 Outer Space Treaty, which, apart from many important things, established that you can't do things that could potentially disrupt the peaceful exploration of outer space by other countries. It's been nearly 57 years since these needles, the successful ones at the very least, had been deployed. Of course, over a long period of time, a lot of these needles have deorbited and burned up in the atmosphere. But what about the clumps? Because a crucial assumption in this estimate was the fact that the radiation pressure from sunlight would push the needles in. The clumps, however, are heavier. And they're still there. It is reported that there are at least 40 clumps still in orbit. It's not that dangerous, but it's debris we could do without. These needles are on a polar orbit and are about 3,600 kilometers up in the sky. Starlink satellites are 300 to 1,300 kilometers up in the sky at a more diagonal orbit. All of this due to an idea called, hey, space is so big, surely humans can't completely cover it with trash, right? Wrong. Space debris is a really serious issue, and even if you're not convinced by the arguments from astronomers, what you should be worried about is Kessler syndrome, where small but fast debris trigger a chain reaction, creating more and more debris, potentially trapping humans and anything we want to send out there for centuries. Also, who's to say how the tides of technological development would go? Like it went with Project Westford and communication satellites, so it might with Starlink and some other communication technology. And to we really want to be in that situation where we probably trapped our species on this rock because we thought we could get better internet? Much like how 60s America thought that the pros of better long-distance communication without the meddlesome commies outweighed the possible cons of space debris, there are some arguments to be made for the pros of technology like Starlink. But does it really outweigh the cons, especially when the pros themselves might be undone sometime in the future? I don't know. That said, if you do have clear skies above you, don't forget to look out for a huge array of white objects all moving in unison. It's kinda cool, and it's kinda horrifying.